Hi, my name is Isaiah, and last summer I went to Wesley Woods Camp. It was the best week of my life. It brought me closer to Jesus and deeper into my faith.
Before I came to Wesley Woods, I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life. I just kind of went with the motions and didn't really know what to do and just didn't really have a huge plan for what I was going to do with my life. But then when I came to Wesley Woods, I immediately found love. I found a family. I found a group of people who I loved spending time with. And because of that, I ended up finding not just a love for people, but a love for God and a love for serving God and a love for serving His amazing kingdom.
Camp actually had a big impact on me. I feel like it taught me a lot of things as a young adult, a lot of fundamental things that I certainly needed to learn as a young adult. And those things really have stuck with me for a long time. You know, I still get up early because I had to get up early at camp, and it's really done well for me.
You get to do canoeing, you get to do rock climbing, you get to do archery, you get to do game zone. All this stuff are fun.
Because of my experience at Wesley Woods, my call into ministry was both fostered and supported wholly. And it was at Wesley Woods that I really got some of the most formative experiences as I began to explore what it would look like to be in leadership in the church.
Their food was really good. Some of the foods I liked was their mac and cheese and spaghetti.
I loved going on the rope course where I was 40 feet in the air. I loved hiking on a cool nature path. And I loved fishing, in which I caught a 14-inch bass.
There's horses, archery, canoeing, fishing. There's a high ropes course. What I liked about the high ropes course was I liked all of it because I'd never done anything like that before. My favorite part was the zip line at the end.
Can I tell them a song? There's a song called Pharaoh Pharaoh, and it goes Pharaoh Pharaoh honk. Pharaoh Pharaoh, what oh baby, let my people go.
You can make so many new friends and learn so many new things. I recommend it. I like going back to camp. Not only just because it's a good place to meet God, but because I also get to meet many new friends and get just develop a great bond with God and these newfound friends.
And I have one more thing. So I have a 99% chance that at the end of the summer, at the end of the week, you're going to be crying because it's going to be super great there, that it's going to be so fun there that you won't want to leave.
Hi friends, my name is Nate Nims. Thank you for joining us at Grace Today. Whether you're with us on YouTube or on Facebook, if you're joining us on Sunday morning or even catching us at another time, however it is you are with us, I am grateful to be with you. Thank you so much for joining us at Grace Today. And if this is your first time with us at Grace, I want to say a special thank you to you. So thank you so much for being with us. It truly is a gift to have this time together, and I am grateful to share it with you. As we begin the service, there are a few announcements to lift up, and the first is that this is Confirmation Sunday. We are welcoming our confirmands as members of Grace, and I am so thankful for their time in our community and all that they have learned and discovered this year together. So help us celebrate the students later in the service. Also later in the service, we will be sharing communion, so make sure you grab something to use for that. Maybe a donut and coffee, cookies and milk, whatever you have is acceptable because at the communion table, everyone is accepted, you too. No one is excluded, and we want to include everyone in this movement of God's grace. I also want to let you know that on Monday of this upcoming week, we are having an immigration forum with JFON. JFON stands for Justice for Our Neighbors, but they are becoming a new organization, and so you'll have an opportunity to hear about this new organization, how they are shifting, and how you can get involved as we help to protect immigrant rights and welcome folks into the community through Grace and through the work of JFON. Finally, I also want to remind you that we are hoping to collect 6,000 cans in this next month to help memorialize all those that we have lost in Iowa due to COVID. We will take those cans and turn them into a labyrinth, and so we can walk with those folks that we have lost and experience a moment of grace and peace together as we live out this memorial and help our community at the same time. If you'd like to drop off canned goods at Grace, you can bring them to the church, and just outside the office doors, we have a collection box ready for you. As we begin the service now, let us pause for a moment of silence.
Please join me in the call to worship. Lord, we believe that you love us. We love you too.
We offer all that we are, all that we have, to you.
Help us to trust, like a little child, that you are always by our side.
Help us to live for you and to honor you in all that we do.
We'll now join together in our opening hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excel.
Love's excelling, joy of them to earth come down. Fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation, and every trembling heart. Breathe, oh breathe, thy loving spirit into every troubled breast. Let us all in thee inherit. Let us find that second rest. Take away our bent to sinning, Alpha and Omega be. And our faith has its beginning, set our hearts at liberty. Come Almighty to deliver, let us all thy life receive. Suddenly return and never, never more thy temples leave. Thee we would be always blessing, serve thee as thy host above. Pray and praise thee without ceasing, glory in thy perfect love. Finish then thy new creation, pure and spotless let us be. Let us see thy great salvation, perfectly restored in thee. Change from glory into glory, till in her we take our place. Till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise.
Would you join me in our opening prayer? Gracious God, we give thanks for this time to revive our hearts and restore our passion for you. Open us to experience the depth and breadth of your love and your grace so abundantly extended to us. In the name of Jesus Christ, your gift to us. Amen.
Please join me in the scripture reading. Today's reading is from Romans chapter 4, verses 3 through 5, chapter 5, verses 1 through 2. What does the scripture say? Abraham had faith in God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Workers' salaries aren't credited to them on the basis of an employer's grace, but rather on the base of what they deserve. But faith is credited as righteousness to those who don't work, because they have faith in God, who makes the ungodly righteous. Therefore, since we have been made righteous through his faithfulness combined with our faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have access by faith to this grace in which we stand through him and boast in the hopeful glory of God.
Part of the reason why at Grace we are exploring the history of the Methodist faith is that our confirmation students have learned a lot about John and Charles Wesley during the last year, and I want to make sure that everyone knows as much as our confirmation students do. John Wesley started a revival in England and it eventually spread around the world. There was this hope that our faith might transform our hearts and lives, and that's what we see in the Wesleyan revival, and that's what we hope to see at Grace today. Now, if you were with us last week, you might remember that we talked about Wesley's time as a fellow at Oxford. Now, to be a fellow at Oxford University in the 1700s meant that you were a professor, and John Wesley was a professor of philosophy and Greek. But fellows also acted as a kind of guidance counselor, and they did that by being priests in the Church of England. It was during this time that Charles Wesley, John's younger brother, was a student at Oxford, and while they were getting ready to graduate, Charles was struggling with his faith. He wasn't sure what he believed. He wasn't quite sure what difference faith could make in the world. So John and Charles and a few other students got together and started the Holy Club. They would meet in John's office or they would meet in a pub on campus and they would read the Bible together. They would pray for one another and they would start to practice their faith in new ways. You might remember last week, if you were with us, that John Wesley decided through this Holy Club to stop cutting his hair. Rather than pay for a haircut and then wear a wig that would have long hair, Wesley decided, why don't I just have long hair? And instead of spending those monies on haircuts, I'll give those monies to charity and people that need them. John was captivated by the idea of holiness, and he kept pursuing it in a multitude of ways. John and Charles Wesley were very rigorous about their faith. You could even say they were methodical about it, which is why they were started to be called Methodist. Their faith was programmed into their schedule. At this time, we will wake up and read the Bible. At this time, we will pray. We will then fast until this time when we pray again, and then we will visit someone in the hospital, and then we will give to the debtor's prison, and so on and so forth. Faith became a very rigid pattern for them. It was a methodical pattern, which is why Methodist began as an insult. Look at those Methodists. Look at how they are so methodical about their faith. Now, this insult eventually became a source of pride for John and Charles Wesley, which is why we are still called Methodist today. But it was during this time that John writes in their journal, "I have been charged with being too strict, with carrying things too far in religion and laying burdens on myself, if not on others, which were neither necessary nor possible to be borne." To be honest, John was taking things too far. He was being too strict. He was forcing on himself and on others things that were not helpful or could even be borne out in a sustained way. But John brushed off those criticisms in their journal and went on to write that he was just trying to be faithful. He was just trying to pursue holiness. So who were they to criticize me? The practices and the methods that John used of prayer, of study, of generosity, of community, all of these practices and all of these methods, they are supposed to help us embrace this life, to have a full and abundant life. It's like Jesus says in the Gospel of John, "I came so that you might have life and have it abundantly." This life of faith is supposed to open us up to awe and wonder as we, with God, seek justice, love kindness, and walk humbly. It should awaken awe and wonder so that we can embrace the totality of this life. But rather than embrace life, John's method of faith made him skeptical. It made him worried because instead of focusing on grace, John became captivated by guilt and shame. John began to think they were never worthy of God's love, and no matter what John got right, if something was wrong, what was wrong mattered more. John Wesley became captivated with the idea that he had to prove himself, that he had to show everyone that he was faithful enough, that he was brave enough, that he was courageous enough to do anything and everything to show his faith. And so John gave up his position as a fellow and decided to be a missionary to what is now Savannah, Georgia. It was in 1732 that the British Empire colonized a community that is now known as Georgia. It was named Georgia in honor of King George II. And not to be outdone, King George had two colonies named after their wife, Caroline. Now, around this same time, there was a reformer in politics named James Oglethorpe. And Oglethorpe was a parliamentarian that wanted to shape a new and better British Empire. And one way that they wanted to do this was by helping people get out of debtor's prison. In England during this time, if you were in debt, you could be thrown in jail. And Oglethorpe realized that if you're in jail, you can't work, so you can't pay off your debt. So they had all of these people sitting in prison without any ability to reform or make their lives better, and Oglethorpe thought, these folks need a second chance. So they convinced King George that these people should be sent to Georgia to start this new colony, to establish it where they can work and develop their new lives and have this opportunity to pay off their debts and be better on the other side of it. Now, in this colony, Oglethorpe decided, well, of course there need to be pastors, and what if we can have pastors there that can speak to the people in town, but hopefully create good relationships with the indigenous folks that are there as well? John Wesley was one of many pastors that volunteered to embark on this journey to Georgia. And John convinced his brother Charles and a few other friends to join him as well. John's outward motivation was to be a pastor, to help folks establish a new community. He could be an educator there as well. He could help folks start a new life in a new and better way. And that excited John because John was trying to do that for himself. His outward motivation looked very altruistic, but his inward motivation wasn't. In John Wesley's journal at this time, he writes that he was going to Georgia to save his own soul. Sure, it was going there to take care of others, but John's real motivation was going to save himself. John Wesley believed that he had to prove how faithful he was. He believed that he needed to show God that he was worthy of love and acceptance. So he took this missionary role to save himself, to show God and to show everyone else, I'm so faithful, this is what I'm going to do. Now, one Wesley historian, Richard Heitzenrader, writes that this was likely the first time in his life that John Wesley was ever on a boat. John had never sailed before, and now John was going to be on a boat from England to Georgia, a trip that took 3 months. And during those 3 months, John Wesley was seasick the majority of the time. There's a passage in the New Testament where it says that we work out our faith with fear and trembling, but I don't think puking over the side of the boat is what they're talking about. John had fear, and John was certainly trembling, but he was going to prove himself one way or another. And so it was, on October 14th, 1735, that John Wesley boarded a ship called the Simmons so they could arrive in Georgia 3 months later. During those 3 months at sea, John wasn't just sick to their stomach, their heart was sick as well. The storms that they faced while at sea shook John Wesley's faith to the core. Now, I do not believe, and I cannot believe, in a God that sends us storms so that we can be hurt, so that we can learn a lesson through our pain. But I do find hope in the God that walks with us through the storm. And the God that sees grace and peace with us here and now as we find our way forward, even while we're in the storm. John Wesley faced a number of storms at sea. And most of the time in our lives, the storms that we deal with are not literal, but they can be just as terrifying. They can blow in and take us off course. We can become disoriented, sick to our core, because we just don't know what to do in this storm. We don't know if we have the endurance or the ability to make it through. Sometimes it feels like storms will have the last word because these challenges and these pains are just so overwhelming and all-encompassing. Imagine being on a boat at sea and all you can see is darkness. Some of you know that storm very well. But your storm does not have to be the final word. When we place our storms in God's hands, God's grace can turn those storms into a defining moment of our lives that opens us up to new possibilities of love, redemption, grace, and peace. I will never claim to know why bad things happen. Because when we are not feeling pain, it can become an interesting philosophical question: why do bad things happen to good people? But when we are feeling pain, it's no longer a question. When we are struck by that storm, it becomes an all-encompassing mystery of misery, and we are lost and confused, just like John Wesley was at sea. Now, the storms of our lives, I don't know why they happen, but I trust that God works with them and works with us to create new possibilities of grace and peace. I trust in this because the people that start cancer foundations have walked through that journey and want to see the world be a better place on the other side. I know that the people that start Alzheimer's support groups have been down that road, and they know just how much it matters for someone to say, "I'm here for you. I know what you're going through. Me too." Those words, "me too," can open up whole new worlds. Pain has the potential to close our hearts, but pain also has the potential, in God's grace, to open our hearts, to expand our love and mercy to others and to ourselves. God is not sending storms to hurt or harm you. That is not who God is. That is not what God is about. God is not causing hurt or pain or destruction. God builds back with grace and peace. God does not hurt or harm us better than that. God brings healing through us so that a hurting world might know grace and peace. As their journey from England to Georgia neared its end, John Wesley wrote in their journal about one of the worst storms at sea they faced. The sail was in tatters. Water was washing over the walls of the ship. It was pouring in all around them. John thought the ship might be swallowed up, that all would be lost. John was terrified. But in the midst of their terror, John Wesley writes in their journal about hearing people sing. On the main level of this ship, there were a group of Christians from Moravia in Germany, known as the Moravians. And these Moravians had gathered during the storm and started to sing around the tattered sails. They were singing hymns and psalms with one another. They were praying for their ship and for their companions. They were offering thanks and praise, trusting that God was with them and that God would be with them always. John was terrified, but he saw their faith and he felt like he didn't have it, because they were singing in the storm, but he was terrified by it. Wesley wanted a faith that could sing through the storm. He wanted to live with the grace and peace that he saw in those Moravian Christians, but instead of trusting in that grace, instead of pursuing that peace, when they landed in Georgia, John Wesley decided to double down on proving just how good and faithful he was. On the ship, they had saved a number of containers of rum, and they were getting ready to have a party when they landed. They spent a few months while on the ship planning a party. They were going to celebrate their arrival in Georgia, but John took these casks of rum and broke them, making sure the party couldn't even get started. When John arrived in Georgia, he was even more rigorous and he was even more methodical. There were more and more burdens that John placed on himself and on others to prove their faith and to make God notice them, because John didn't believe that he was worthy or accepted or loved. John believed that he had to prove himself, so he was going to be even more rigorous, even more methodical, no matter what. Some people were attracted to this, but many people just thought John was asking too much. For instance, while at their new church, John Wesley started a 5 a.m. prayer service, and that is too much for me. I don't know if you're a morning person, but I certainly am not. John started this morning prayer service, and people could come if they chose, and that was good enough for a while. But eventually, John Wesley decided, we're going to have this prayer service every day at 5 a.m., and if you don't come every day at 5 a.m., when Sunday comes around, if you come up for communion, you are not going to get it. You are not going to be welcomed at Christ's table because you didn't prove yourself during the week. So you better show up every day at 5, because if you don't, you aren't good enough. It was this kind of rigorous and methodical faith that led a church member to write to Wesley, "I like nothing you do. Indeed, there is neither a man nor a woman in the town who minds a word you say, and so you may preach long enough, but nobody will come to hear you. Every pastor receives a note like that from time to time. But I have never received a note that says, I like nothing about you, and no one else likes you either. It's almost as if John became so captivated by the idea of holiness that they forgot what it means to be holy. John thought faith was about having this pattern or this practice for the sake of having this pattern and practice to prove to God that you were worthy and that you deserved to be loved. John forgot about faith leading to the fruits of the Spirit that Paul writes about in Galatians, that we should have these patterns and practices of faith in our lives that lead us to be more loving, more peaceful, more patient, more generous, to have self-control, grace, and peace. This should be the fruit of our faith, not a rigorous faith that chases people away, but a loving faith that welcomes them in. John Wesley arrived in Georgia early in 1736. And by the summer of that year, John had not chased everyone out of the church, just most people stopped showing up. But a small group kept coming to church and being with John at 5 a.m. for prayer and study, and then showing up again on Sundays for service and communion. One person that kept showing up was Sophie Hopke. Sophie was 18, and Sophie was hoping to be engaged because she was engaged once, but that previous partner was now in jail for forgery. So when Sophie met John and saw that he was single and not in prison, Sophie thought John was a real catch. However, there was a catch in their relationship because Sophie was 18 and John was 32. Now, we can excuse this for being a product of their time, but that was a bit of an age difference there. But Sophie liked John, John seemed to like Sophie, and Sophie's family liked John as well. However, John had decided before going to Georgia that he wanted to live a more monastic life. He wanted to be devoted fully to following God, which meant he could never give himself to a relationship. But Sophie kept pursuing John, and they became closer and closer friends. Eventually, though, as things became more romantic, John just broke down and told Sophie, "Sophie, I can't do this. I made a vow to God, and if I break that vow, what would God think of me?" So John said to Sophie, "The married life just isn't for me. I am going to be single so I can be devoted to my faith and the church." And that's when Sophie said, "Well, John, what if I'm single with you? What if we can be single together?" Now, John thought that was a great idea because John could have the best of both worlds, but Sophie thought, if I can hook him on this, maybe eventually he'll put a ring on it. But John Wesley never put a ring on it. After a while, their relationship stopped growing and developing because John was convinced we're single together, so why would things get any more romantic or interesting? Let's just stay the same. But that's not what Sophie had in mind. So Sophie started to date other people, which was fine because Sophie and John were single together. They weren't an item. They weren't a couple. So what does it matter to John? He's just going to be single anyway. Sophie was about to be engaged and married. And that's when someone came to John Wesley, a member of Sophie's family, and they said to John, "You know Sophie's about to get married, right?" And John didn't believe them. John thought, "No, we agreed to be single together. Sophie's not going to get married. She would have told me that by now." But this family member of Sophie insisted, "In 3 days, Sophie's going to be married to someone else unless you say something first." Wesley had 3 days to say to Sophie, "I want to spend my life with you." He had 3 days to devote his love to her or to let her go, and they could have lived peacefully ever after, one way or another. But Wesley believed Sophie was going to be single with him. He believed he had nothing to fear. He was going to have the best of both worlds, and nothing could stop that. Until Wesley learned a few days later that Sophie was indeed married. And so John Wesley wrote Sophie a letter calling her a liar and a cheat and a fraud, saying that she had sinned against God and against him. Wesley went so far to say that if you come to church and ask for communion, I will not serve you because you are not worthy. But Sophie was a strong-willed woman. So she and her new husband showed up at church the next Sunday. And when it was time to go up front for communion, John refused to serve them. More than that, though, John didn't just refuse to serve them and usher them away. John took a moment to announce to the whole congregation, "This is why these people are not worthy of communion. This is why they are a shame to our congregation." The church did not take that very well. In fact, John Wesley was thrown in prison on charges of defamation. And let's be honest, John was in the wrong here. Sophie didn't do anything wrong, but John was so caught up in his own ego being bruised that he just took out his anger on her and her new husband. John stayed in jail for a while. Because he didn't have anyone to bail him out, he just sort of sat there and twiddled his thumbs for a bit. But eventually, John got out of jail, and the next few months in his life lived out like a soap opera. The few people that had still been at church stopped going completely. The church was empty, and no one in town wanted anything to do with John. He was a persona non grata. Nobody wanted to be associated with him anymore. So one night, in the middle of the night, John snuck out of town. Their trial had been postponed again. They didn't know what to do, but they knew they just couldn't stay there. So they snuck out of town, they fled to the Carolinas, and they boarded a ship to go back to England, and he had his tail tucked between his legs the entire time. If John Wesley would have stayed in Georgia, they would have become an angry fundamentalist pastor shouting at an empty church. John could have wallowed in their shame and guilt and pain. They could have just sat in that storm. But instead, they trusted it to be transformed by God. Now, John didn't know it at the time, and if you would have told John it gets better, I'm not sure if John would have believed you. Because all John felt for less than a year was the storm of doubt and devastation. They didn't even last 12 months in Georgia, and their life and their faith was completely destroyed. But God took that destruction and turned it into revival. Because for years, John thought, "I will save myself. I will prove to God that I am worthy of love." John thought their way to a faith, but their thoughts were not enough. And the storm that they lived with, it moved their faith from their head to their heart. And eventually, they found their way to trusting the all-encompassing love of God. And when they did, everything was transformed around them and around the world through the Methodist revival as well. When John Wesley arrived back in England, he was a broken man. His faith was gone. In his journals from this time, he writes about not knowing what he believes, if he believes anything at all. But the truth was, when John arrived back in England, he needed to work. And he could work as a priest, he just wasn't sure what to do. A friend of his, Peter Bowler, was getting ready to go from England to Georgia. And before Peter Bowler left for Georgia, they gave Wesley some advice. They said, "Preach faith until you have it, and when you have it, preach faith." Wesley wasn't really sure what this meant. They didn't think it was the greatest of advice, but they started to take it anyway. Wesley started to preach faith. They started to preach grace and peace and compassion and mercy, having a faith that lives in your head but also lives in your heart. And slowly, over time, Wesley's faith was strangely warmed, most especially on a night at Aldersgate Street. We don't know all the details of what happened in this house on Aldersgate Street, but we do know a few friends were meeting together, encouraging one another in their faith. This is what John writes in their journal. "In the evening, I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street, where one was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans. About a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. I testified then openly to all there what I now first felt in my heart. It was in this moment, as their heart was strangely warmed, that John realized they were accepted and they were loved. They began to see that the practices and the methods of their faith, they were important, they could be helpful, but they weren't the point. The point is, and the only point that matters, is grace. You are loved, you are accepted, and God's grace is with you. There is nothing you have to earn, there is nothing you have to achieve. God's grace is already yours, waiting to warm your heart. As we read from Romans today, therefore, since we have been made righteous through his faithfulness, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have access by faith into this grace in which we stand through him, and we boast in the hope of God's glory. Through Christ, we come to know God's grace and peace. We come to see how we are already accepted and loved just as we are. And now, with this acceptance, we can pursue righteousness and holiness, not because there is anything that we have to prove, but because we have been saved from our sins. We have been saved for living out our salvation, for passing on this grace and peace to ourselves and to others, to pursuing a holiness that reflects those fruits of the Spirit, so that we might know peace, patience, joy, gentleness, kindness, and self-control, so that we can live the good and abundant life that Jesus came to give to us. The theologian Paul Tillich sums up a lot of the tension that we see in Wesley's life and the acceptance that we have finally arrived at. And so I want to share some of Tillich's words with you. They write, "It strikes us when year after year, the longed-for perfection of life does not appear. When the old compulsions reign within us as they have for decades, when despair destroys all joy and courage. Sometimes in that moment, a wave of light breaks into our darkness, and it is as though a voice were saying, 'You are accepted. You are accepted, accepted by that which is greater than you. Do not try to do anything now. Perhaps later you will do much. Do not seek for anything. Do not perform anything. Do not intend anything. Simply accept the fact that you are accepted.'" In the United Methodist Church, one way that we strive to live with this acceptance is through confirmation. Through helping students learn to see that they can claim this acceptance for themselves and share it with others. And that is what we are celebrating today. These students coming to know that they are accepted, they are loved, and that we all, as the church, will help them to remember, no matter what, they are accepted and they are loved. Another way that we seek to live out this acceptance is through communion. Now, what John Wesley came to know and that we now live out is that no one can be excluded. Everyone is welcome to the table because the table does not belong to us. It belongs to Jesus. And at Jesus' Last Supper, Peter was there, even though they would deny Jesus a few moments later. Judas was there, but Judas ate too, even though just after the meal ended, Judas would betray Jesus. Jesus welcomed everyone to the table. Jesus accepted everyone at the table. And so that's what we're going to do together as well. No matter what, you are accepted here because God's acceptance and grace are yours. Now this acceptance, it does come with some accountability. Jesus invites everyone to the table, but then Jesus wants us to learn some table manners as well. A little while later, as we get into the confirmation liturgy, you're going to hear some of those table manners. But even if you don't know what fork to use, even if you put your elbows on the table, even if you talk with a bit of food in your mouth and don't know which tiny plate is your saucer or for bread, even if you don't know those table manners and you get things mixed up, you're still accepted here. God's grace is still with you, no matter what. And that's what matters right now. So as we get ready to share communion, may our hearts be strangely warmed. On the eve of Jesus' arrest, He gathered around the table with some friends to celebrate the Exodus and remember the Passover, to know that God's liberation and love will always hear the cry of the oppressed, and we are called to share this liberation wherever God's love leads us. So during the meal, Jesus took some bread, broke it, gave it to the disciples, gave thanks to God, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the meal was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to God, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, drink. This is my blood for you and for many, poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so we together join in remembrance of these mighty acts of God's acceptance, love, liberation, grace, and peace, because reconciliation and acceptance were found at the table. Even though this was a tense and dangerous time, God's grace was there with them and for them. And God's grace is here with us now, even in our own tense and dangerous times. You are not alone, because you are at this table of God's acceptance, surrounded by companions that say, "Yes, you are accepted, I am accepted. We will draw this circle wider and wider still." Which is why we gather for communion, to remember and to celebrate our acceptance and to share it wherever we go. So whatever you have to celebrate communion, it is acceptable because you are accepted by God. The body and the blood of Christ given for you. Let us now celebrate our confirmation students as we welcome them as new members of Grace.
I will now do the presentation of the confirmands. And when I say your name, if you would come forward, just the confirmand, and stand in the spot that we talked about earlier, and it's marked with your envelope and your name. Talia Stewart Rooney. Oscar Lyle Erickson. Lauren Brooke Hutchings. Sadie Ann Sawyer. Sadie is not able to be here today. And James Lily Steinberg.
I invite you to join me in the responsive reading. Siblings in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through the water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, offered to us without price. Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church.
So on behalf of the whole church, I ask, do you believe in God's love that convinces us the need to turn away from the forces of wickedness and evil in this world and to repent of your sins? If so, please say, "I do."
I do.
And also to the confirmants, do you believe that God's Spirit is active in the world and within you to give you the freedom and power to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, "I do."
I do.
And again to the confirmants, I would ask you, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to all people of all ages, all nations, and all races? If so, say, "I do."
I do.
And this question is for the family and friends and mentors gathered here and watching the service online. Will you, these candidates, support and encourage them in their Christian life and faith? If so, please say, "We will."
We will.
And again, to the whole congregation, those gathered here and those joining us online, will you, as Christ's body, as the church, nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care? Family and mentors, you can join me in reading the following response, and the people watching online can like the video, and that makes that little cascade of thumbs up. That's just fun to see. So, let's join together in this.
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life.
After each youth is confirmed, their mentor will present them with a cross, which will be hung on the cross wall at the back of the sanctuary. If you turn around real quick, you can see that. Each cross serves as a reminder that these young people publicly professed their Christian faith and their commitment to grace and to Christ's church. These crosses will stay on the wall until the recipient completes high school. At that time, the students will be presented with the cross to take with them as they continue on in their life journey and to serve as a reminder of the love and support each student received during their time at Grace.
So I'll invite each confirmant to come forward to this kneeling rail, and their parents and mentors can come and join them as well and stand behind them at the kneeling. Talia? Remember your baptism in the night. I need to dry your hands. Talia, the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born from water and spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ.
Go ahead and say that. And if you would present. So there's presenting Talia with your cross. Thank you. You may return to your seat. If you would return to your spot again.
Awesome. Awesome. Remember your baptism. The Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Remember your baptism and be thankful. The Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
You have confirmed your faith in Jesus Christ and are part of God's universal church. But we now ask you two more questions that deal with where you'll find your faith home within that larger body. So I ask you, confirmands, as members of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church in whatever form it may take in our future that best matches your understanding of the gospel? And will you do all in your power to strengthen the ministries of that church? If so, say, I will.
I will.
As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and to your care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian life. As members together with you in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. So Talia, Oscar, Lauren, James, may the God of all grace who has called us to eternal glory in Christ establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, so that you might live in grace and peace. Amen.
And you may go ahead. Yeah, let's congratulate them and welcome them.
Let us pray. Creative One, come and open our hearts, our minds, and our shared sense of possibility. Help us to perceive the multitude of opportunities to live out your desires for us. As a community, fill us with passion for discerning your will and living it out with courage. Spirit of joy, we give thanks for your acceptance and offer our lives with gratitude for your sustenance. No matter what barriers may come our way, keep us steady in the promises we make to one another through proclamations of love and solidarity. For all our prayers, spoken or only sighed, may we trust our spirits to your grace. We pray all of this and more through Christ who taught us to pray, saying, Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you for being with us at Grace today. This time together truly is a gift, and it is only made possible thanks to your gifts. Your financial support of Grace makes our mission and ministry possible. And so if you would like to financially support us at Grace, one of the best ways for you to do so at this time is by giving online at gracedesmoines.org. You can also mail your gift to us at 3700 Cottage Grove, Des Moines, Iowa, 50311. But as we just said in the covenant with our confirmation students, our gift is not just financial. We covenant to share our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness with one another. So what are you going to do to witness to your acceptance this week? Or perhaps you can even remember the words of Tillich that say, don't rush to do anything, don't even intend to do anything, simply accept that you are accepted. There's a bad pastor's joke that goes around in Methodist circles where it says, do you know what the Buddhist said to the Methodist? Don't just do something, sit there. What does it look like for you to sit there in your acceptance? How can your heart be strangely warmed, not because there is anything that you have to do, not because there is anything that you have to achieve, but because you are already accepted just as you are? May you feel that acceptance this week, and may you share it with others however you interact with them. That is your offering this week. Live in to that love of your acceptance. Don't intend anything, don't do something, just know you are accepted and let it overflow from there. As our service comes to a close, we'll join together in the hymn, O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Thank you very much for joining us at Grace, and until next week, grace and peace.
praise the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of Thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of cancelled sin, He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, His blood availed for me.